Thank you. So welcome to the panelists. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of a background so that this, as you know, the demonetization episode happened in November. It was a really bold move by Prime Minister Modi, and it has political and economic ramifications. It may have had economic and political motivations. You know, it was difficult to actually assess what was the real rationale behind it. So the first question I'd like to ask the panelists, and maybe first they can give a bit of their thoughts on what they think of the real rationale behind demonetization, and if they were to put on their economics hat and imagine that they were with Prime Minister Modi when he was deciding whether to do this exercise or not, what would they say? So that's my first question to the panelists. The order in which we'll go is first Professor Bhalla, and then Professor Ghatak, and then Professor Desai. Yeah.
Thank you. You know, that's a good question. What would an economist say if he was asked, or she was asked, as to whether demonetization should be done? And what I believe is I don't think there's any economist around anywhere who would say, go ahead and do it. That is the importance of this. Because, you know, what are you trained to do? You're trained to look at the data. This is our training. And maybe it's the inadequacy of our thinking, but not of our training. You're trained to look at data and extrapolate from data, from experience, from other countries' experience, etc. This experiment has never been done before. When it happened, there were all these guys saying, oh, listen, you know, this happened in Libya and this happened in Zimbabwe or whatever. Every country where demonetization has been practiced has had hyperinflation. Now, maybe the RBI thinks we have hyperinflation, but clearly an inflation rate of 4% or 5% and a growth rate of 7% doesn't, if you will, indicate any need for demonetization. So the question is, why was it done? And, you know, there will be, and I'm sure some of you will write it, there'll be PhD thesis galore written around the world by economists on this experiment. So we are now 3 months into this, and as you all know, when Deng Xiaoping was asked about what did he think about the French Revolution, whether it had worked, he said, it's a bit too early to tell. Similarly, I don't think it's very useful to try and analyze as to whether demonetization has succeeded or not. Having made that caveat, and if you will, that not apology, but at least covering all grounds, I would say I have been, and let me confess, I've been an ardent supporter of demonetization after it happened. And the primary reason for my support is that this is the one exercise that will bring down tax evasion in India. And if you will, and you should all read The Curse of Cash by Ken Rogoff, and I will be writing on this soon, but basically I think Modi or his team got the idea of demonetization from none other than Ken Rogoff. I'll leave you with two statistics. Ken Rogoff makes his point in this book, written before the demonetization of India, where he's arguing against the $100 bill being used in the US, and he says that the $100 bills constitute 80% of the cash in the US. 500 and 1,000 rupee bills constitute 86% of the cash in India. Maybe a mere coincidence, but we can go into this later. But really, the idea is a very sound one, and I think it will work gloriously on the economic side. And as you know, it seems to have already worked gloriously on the political side.
Okay, thank you. Can I be heard at the back?
Yeah.
So it's a great question. In fact, it's a hypothetical question. because by the testimony of Arvind Subramaniam and Urjit Patel and all the economists in the sort of Team Modi, economists were not consulted on demonetization. So therefore, it's a great question to ask, and let me begin on that note. So I wrote a piece right after the demonetization policy was announced and implemented. And I had today, when the election results came out, where absolutely under Modi's leadership, the BJP has won a landslide in Uttar Pradesh, and all the political in political terms, that's a huge achievement, no doubt about it. So I went back to my column and I looked at what I had written in the end. I had said that the magic of Modinomics is yet to be realized, but Moditics is a winner. And I can claim some credit saying, as somebody who has been a consistent critique of some of the government's policies, and the previous ones too, that as Dr. Bhalla pointed out, from the point of view of economics, there's very little to muster in support of demonetization. At a macro level, it's a shock of 86% of liquidity temporarily being taken out of the system. And also the reason where I would slightly disagree with Dr. Bhalla, Ken Rogoff himself has written on India's demonetization, and the main reason why the Indian experiment is different from what Rogoff is writing about, Rogoff is essentially saying eliminate high currency denominations. He's not saying substitute it. So fundamentally, these are related but different policies. Okay, so on that, therefore, I would say the only, rationale that if I put on my objective hat as an economist that you could give for this such a policy is it's a kind of big push or a shock therapy to move the economy to a more digital economy, where as again I agree with Dr. Bhalla that one of our scandals of our tax system is effectively only 1% of Indians pay income taxes. That's largely because agricultural income is not taxed, the informal sector is largely outside the tax net and all of that. So therefore, you could make cases like that. So that I would say as an economic argument that does work. But where I think that in a lot of this discussion, something is getting missed, and this shows up in whether, look, the GDP growth projection was revised downwards, but hey, in the third quarter, it's not so bad and all of that. As anybody who has looked at national income statistics knows, that the informal sector is largely unaccounted for in our national income statistics. It's a kind of projection you'd essentially extrapolate from some formal sector numbers into the informal sector. And by all accounts, the informal sector was hurt because it's largely a cash-dependent economy. So we should separate out the black money issue versus the rickshaw pullers and the pan shops and others using cash. And this brings to my second point. In an economy where one-third of the population has internet access, and really one-third of the population has access to smartphones, we should go to the digital economy. There's nobody can dispute that. As much as we should try to get rid of actual retailing because of the urban scarcity, space scarcity, and we should go to online retailing. But tomorrow, we cannot ban all Kirana shops, because that we will hope will push the economy into having more and more Amazon or whatever these kind of things. So that's really my main summary of the economic point of view. But politically, I have to say, the reason I predicted, and I take no particular pleasure in something having political dividends when its economic argument, according to at least from my perspective, is not solid at all. Politically, it's a very successful move, and you could have predicted it's going to go that way, simply because this is what we economists call was the most credible signaling or advertising device ever. So in game theory, we often say, in order to negotiate, if I burn a $100 bill, I'm signaling to others that, hey, I don't care that much about money. I'm signaling that I'm really after something else. So I think what PM Modi has very credibly said, look, what I'm doing with the cash is not a side thing that people do with big businesses. That's how our existing politics works. I've done something that will affect Ratan Tata, Mukesh Ambani, and any of us who, anytime we are in India, whether they then get other guys to stand in the line and whatever. But it is a credible signaling device that, look, I have at least some seriousness of intent there. And it's universal. And what I think is still a puzzle, and I hopefully will come back in this panel and from the audience, given that the poor were hurt, the fact that they still voted for Modi, you know, again, we don't know the detailed analysis, but clearly to get this kind of a margin, you have to have a large support coming from all classes. So are they therefore in some way saying that, look, this was tough on us, but hey, the rich also got punished, and maybe they got punished more because they hoarded cash more. Maybe that was their thinking. So once again, I would summarize, and I want to, you know, give Meghnad, who my colleague and mentor for a long time at LSE, he welcomed me when I was here as a junior rookie out of the, you know, after my PhD. So I would basically come back to say that Modinomics, in terms of, as we have seen in demonetization, has very little positives in terms of its actual economic gains. Now, how much damage, how long it will take to recover, this we can discuss, okay? But Moditics, I think we can basically, as many have commented, we can expect that 2019 election results, it's a safe bet to predict sitting here, is that, you know, Modi's political stature has kept on rising, and it will possibly, that's a momentum that will only significantly increase after that.
Well, you know, I'm old enough to remember that among Indian economists, we used to discuss how to do something about black money. And we were also engaged in trying to estimate what proportion of GDP was due to black money. I mean, we didn't have any numbers, but we kind of, you know, the World Bank was guessing, so we were guessing. And the key to me was to realize that actually black money was not just a hoard of cash sitting idly. It was a hoard of cash circulating. And therefore, what was the circuit of black money? We were all trying to work out how much profit you could make out of black money. And so thinking about how to get rid of black money, I'm sorry to say that about 12 years before Ken Rogoff, I proposed that in a public speech to the Reserve Bank of India, that demonetization should be done. I'm kind of a fantasist. So I used to fantasize, how would I eliminate black money? Of course, I had to be prime minister. Of course, the fact that I deserved to be prime minister was beyond question. I just didn't want to put any effort into it. And then I thought, if I was a prime minister and if I wanted to eliminate hoards of black money, I couldn't possibly talk to my cabinet because they'll all be full of black money. Who could I talk to? Well, I would have to tell the president of the country that I was about to do this horrendous thing with money. But then I thought the real problem was not actually getting rid of old money. I'll tell you in a minute how I did it. But getting new money in place. You see, I thought the problem was not eliminating old money. It's kind of mechanical. But how do you get new money into place before you eliminate old money? And so I had thought, oh, this is serious, I thought what I would do as a prime minister, would I would create a fake emergency. A fake emergency, you know, terrorist attack from Pakistan or or Nepal or whatever. And then there would be army trucks going across the country, in every corner of the country. And since there are army trucks, nobody's going to question. Well, those army trucks would have the new currency. And then I would announce on November the 8th, 2016, or whatever, that basically I'm not just so, while I'm eliminating old money, old cash, everybody would get up to, say, you know, 2.5 lakhs, 20 lakhs, whatever it is, some number, 1-to-1. Across the counter, 1-to-1 exchange for old cash for new cash. You know, like in Aladdin and the magic lamp. I don't know if you remember Aladdin and the magic lamp. You exchange old lamp for new lamp. And then beyond that limit, if you had to buy zero coupon bonds, zero interest rate yielding bonds, which you could sell 2 months after a certain deadline. the idea was that those bonds would be sold at a discount and the holders would suffer, you know, 20-30% tax on the holds. But what would happen is that everybody would get at the counter, one-to-one, new currency or old currency. And you see, the thing about, you know, the trick about demonetization is everybody concentrates on old money. Now, you know, those of you who have done at least second year undergraduate money and banking, money is what? Money is cash plus deposits, demand deposits, right? So what happens? You say, let old cash be turned into deposits. So you don't actually shrunk the money supply. The money supply has not been shrunk. Cash has been shrunk. And the problem was that the replacement of old cash for new cash was delayed. The incompetence was not in what happened to old cash. The incompetence was in not having new cash ready. And, you know, I wrote about 5 or 6 articles about this between December and January, November and December and January. And one of them I said that basically what this proves that the civil services is not fit for the job. And then none of them have any practical knowledge of how the world works. Not one of them has seen an ATM machine, nor gone to a bank to withdraw money because some carcoon goes for them to withdraw money. They have absolutely no knowledge of how, if you grow up in UK or USA, as they know, you get some experience of how the practical world works. You know, your parents would say, go learn wallpapering or you know. The great Indian upper caste tell you, avoid all practical knowledge because others are there to do it for you. Don't do, and I'm talking about my life. My parent told me, don't waste your time doing this practical thing. We'll find somebody to do it for you. You study. You read books. Right? So everybody in the PMO is very good at reading books, reading rules and regulations. They know nothing about how the economy works. And this is what we suffered from. What we suffered from was total incompetence of getting new currency ready in place when the old currency were being eliminated. And the most shocking thing I've heard, which may be true, is that the 2,000 rupee notes was invented, or was thought of, because they didn't have enough paper to print new currency. Can you believe this? This country wants to be one of the richest countries in the world, and having done that, they didn't have enough supply of paper to put the currency on. And nobody had checked out that the printing presses don't have sufficient capacity to print the new currency in time. I mean, until recently, Indian currency was not printed in India, thank God. It was printed by Dalaru, who operated here. But then suddenly Dalaru was sacked, and we nationalized it. And of course, like all nationalization, it's a complete failure. So that's what happens. But it's literally true that the 2,000 rupee note is shorter than the 1,000 rupee note because they wanted to get more notes out of the same amount of paper. And that's how the ATM crashed. Now, okay, that is episodic. What is the economic effect of this particular thing? Well, there is a small period, maybe 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks, in which the new currency is not being made available at the rate at which the old currency is disappearing. I happened to be in India at that time, so I stood in queue in my bank and all that, so I know it is. Now, the problem is, informal sector, everybody says, in a nice informal sector, because it's not measured, you can say any story about it. You can never be proved wrong. But basically, these are small ticket items. These are small ticket items of frequently bought goods. And some of those goods are perishable, so you can't stock them. Neither the seller can stock them, nor the buyer can stock them. So there's no doubt a disruption in the sale of low ticket items. But anything that you could write a check for, or you could do a debit card for, or a credit card for, you could buy. Because money has not been reduced. Its form has changed from cash to demand deposits. So it's a very peculiar thing in which the disequilibrium effects of the monetary shock is confined to the cash end of it, which is why, you know, casual laborer and people like that were suffering. But it is ultimately a small part of the economy. Yes, there is misery. Now, why did the misery not hurt the government? And as it has, and I don't do any field work. I'm an economist. I sit at home and think. But people who have been out there, journalists and so on, they said it's very simple. The life of the poor in India is always like this. They're always queuing. They're always short of money. Casual laborers don't get work, not because there is shortage of cash, but because shortage of work. So very often casual laborers are used to not finding daily. And they call daily laborers, but doesn't mean they get a job every day. So ultimately for them, the hardship was not shocking. It's people who write on Facebook who are shocked. And the people who went and told television stations this agonizing story. And you know, I was there and it was like fantasy land, especially among the political parties. And the economic ignorance was such that people started making fantasy estimates of how much a GDP would suffer and so on. Some consulting firm said 3.5%. Somebody said, Manmohan Singh said 2%. I mean, I felt sorry for him. He probably was told by Rahul Gandhi to say something. If you are in the third quarter of a fiscal year, financial year, and the second half of the third quarter, there is a monetary shock. Okay? Imagine how far output would have to fall for the growth rate to reduce by 2 percentage points. I mean, you require a famine of a severe kind to affect the growth rate that much. I mean, it's simple arithmetic. Okay, you can all do this exercise, go home and do the exercise. How much would output have to fall by in the second half of third quarter for the entire year's growth rate to suffer by 2 percentage points? It's a serious sum of sense number. Okay, so I think all that is over. Whatever the numbers are being currently published will be revised again. So I don't consider 7.3 or 7.1 a serious number. The nice thing about economics is, let alone predicting, we don't even know what happened in the past. I don't for sure know what happened 2 years ago. But the sum total of it is that actually the monetary shock was a much more limited kind than what people thought. You know, don't worry about what percentage of old money was back or not. That had no economic impact. The economic impact was the failure of delivering the new currency. And that is just administrative incompetence, which had an economic effect, but not a large one.
Thank you, Lord Desai. So to summarize, it seems that among our panelists, Lord Desai, among the economists, we have Lord Desai, who would have advised on demonetization, although he would have done it in a more practical way, perhaps. So my question to the panel is: okay, now that you know it happened, what the stated objective was, you know, to curb corruption and to cut down on black money. So has that objective actually been achieved? And was this really, I mean, coming down to my last question, was this really the most, the cost-effective way to do it? And secondly, also that, coming back to your point about the civil service, surely the Prime Minister and the government would have known that these are constraints that we face. And, you know, in spite of that, the demonetization went ahead. So do you, what do you want to say on that? Let's ask Professor Khattak first.
Okay, thanks. So I'm in a bit of a dilemma because there's
He wants to talk about why I'm wrong.
Exactly.
Before
so
he goes
so
any
much
further.
That Meghnad said that one can. So I'll just, you know, I don't want to stick to the format of the forum.
We
so I'll just
disagree.
Make,
what are you talking
about? I'll just make two quick points. So I think he's exactly right that the contribution of the informal sector to overall GDP is relatively small, but it employs 80% of people. So I'm particularly surprised that, you know, especially for some like Meghnad, who has been on the political sort of left and, you know, in the Labour Party and in all sorts of, you know, discussions, sort of the, you know, it's really, it's not about the sum total of output. That's a very old Soviet style kind of thinking, right? It's really what...
Why the Soviet style?
No, no, I'm
it
saying...
It was invented before the Soviet Union.
No, fair enough. But if 80% people are in the informal sector, to so, call it a small
that
amount,
that
seems
cash,
to be completely...
But that doesn't mean they're cash paid.
That's...
No,
let me finish. So, you know.
I mean, don't confuse those two things.
No. So, and also,
you
I think.
Those two things.
Okay, sorry, I didn't interrupt
two LSE
you.
Guys.
I didn't interrupt you. I think you should stick to, you know. So, anyway, so I would say that. So, first of all, that statement that if you take in all the informal sector workers, it's something that you can simple search in all the sort of data sources will point out. Agriculture and service sector, all these things taken together, employs 80% of people. So that's not a small thing. Number two, just to give an example, arithmetic example, since that was mentioned, you can say that, look, suppose consider an economy where essentially 90 people earn 1 rupee each. Okay, so that's 90 rupees, and one person earns, say, 900 rupees. Just to give an example, right? In this economy, you can do the calculation, take 20% of income cut to all those poor people who are earning, you know, those 90 people who are earning 1 rupee, and suppose the very rich person is not affected. If you look at overall GDP, the effect will be minuscule. Just, you know, I can't do this in my head, but it'll be just a couple of percentages, okay? But for the large section of the economy where you'll say where the poor people inhabit, that will be a 20% shock. So therefore, to say that I agree with Meghnad, so since I have sharply sort of pointed out where I disagree, that the reality is that the poor still voted, and electorally, clearly, they made a cost-benefit calculation that whatever, you know, I was in India until sort of, you know, the end of December, and in and the city of Calcutta, the ATMs where this is well after the 6 weeks, whatever, and, you know, that happened also January and so on. But I would say that, fine, that's an implementation problem, right? So therefore, coming back to now to the question, and I'll be brief since I sort of address some of Meghnad's comments in my earlier statement. So look, corruption is about institutions. It's how people play a game. And cash is about the currency in which the gains from these, you know, corrupt activities, or for that matter, non-corrupt activities, that's the token that you keep. The game goes on. Unless with the digitization, other measures, you know, there, I'm not saying that game cannot be controlled, just affecting the tokens. So just the equivalent would be, as of now, we are using green tokens, the old money, and from tomorrow, it'll all be red tokens. You'll have to stand up in queue and get the red tokens instead of the green tokens to somehow think that will change the institutional structure of the economy, the bureaucracy, the regulation, you know, the kind of crony capitalism. That to me seems, you know, to be a bit of a stretch. Now, having said that, you could well say that, hey, it's a big problem. You need to approach it from several angles. There, I think, again, I'll try to be as focused to Amrita's question. Was this the most productive sort of, you know, an effective bullet to fire if this is really your sort of key, you know, objective? I'll stop here.
So, let me try and answer. And I'll come to the your basic question last, but I want to clear up some of the cobwebs that have occurred. First is that how much of the GDP was affected? And you mentioned agriculture, etc. Look, the demonetization happened on 8th of November. As you all know, that the Ministry of Finance holds these meetings with economists, with agricultural economists, with business leaders, etc., before the budget. So the pre-pone, the budget meeting with agricultural economists on the 18th of November, which is 10 days after the demonetization. And what did most people say? They listen, forget it, the rubber crop has had it, the agriculture will go to naught. You know, and I'm sure Amartya Sen probably said somewhere that this is a reoccurrence of the 1941 famine, and so on and so forth. What happened? The rabi crop acreage went up by 7%. 7%. Now, some of it had to go up because the previous 2 years were drought years. But here are all these leading economists sitting there, and there was one person, or a couple of people, but one person who's a farmer, who said, listen, this won't happen. The reason it won't happen is because in rural areas, and that tells you how little all of us urban folks know about, but I think some of us who travel know this to be a fact. And you know, Calcutta, you were affected by the great leader Mamata Banerjee. Her black money was infinitely affected, and therefore she was on a propaganda thing. And since all the leading economists come from Bengal,
we're talking about lights. Okay. We're talking about Indian lights. Yeah. Anyway, let's not get regional here.
I'll come. You got to take a little bit. So what happened? So basically, he said that in rural areas, a lot of arrangement is by recognition. Okay, these are long-term relationships. Everybody knows, you guys think on Facebook you know somebody. In rural areas, they actually know everybody. And therefore, it was all done on a credit system and knowledge system that, listen, you'll come back and so on and so forth. So that's the first point. The second point, implementation. We all know implementation was bad. Now, I think there's a considerable bit of evidence, circumstantial evidence, to suggest that the whole exercise was pre-bought. There were some mistakes about the notes and the sizes and the machines, but just think of the counterfactual, right? You economists are trained, I'm sure you're training them to think about the counterfactual. Sure. So the counterfactual is, if the government had started stocking up the ATM machines, how long do you think it'll last before everybody knew about it? I think this is underappreciated, that they really, secrecy was of the essence. And I think they preponed it because word was already leaking out. So the paper, etc., they were suddenly to order 20 million tons of paper, and you know, we'll all know, that's India. So therefore, I think, let us not, you know, there clearly was a lot of pain involved, especially for the bottom half of the population, absolutely no question. But it is the case that very likely it was preponed. Now we come to the costs of demonetization, and the last thing that I will address is this, what do you do about black money? What everybody failed, really, and you know, starting from poor Manon Singh, who was, I guess, forced in some way to say what he did, there was, you know, this Andy Warhol moment for Ambit Capital, who said that the GDP will collapse to, you know, 15 minutes of fame, GDP will collapse to 3.5%, which incidentally the math meant that GDP will be zero for the rest of the year. I mean, you know, talk about being mindless beyond compare. So, agriculture, right? And the other thing that everybody missed, almost everybody, I'll be immodest and claim that I did not miss it since I explicitly wrote about it. We had 2 years of drought. Therefore, agriculture, before this demonetization, some of us were saying was going to grow at 8%. And that didn't take any rocket science, that was not demonetization, that if the rabi acreage was to be, and Khalif acreage had already happened, Khalif output had already happened, so therefore agriculture would grow at 8%. Now, it turns out agriculture is very likely going to grow at 8%. So, and therefore the GDP, or 7, 8%, therefore GDP will be above 7% for this year. It is not that the GDP data are being fudged, it will be above. Does that mean that demonetization didn't have a cost? Absolutely not. Demonetization had a cost, and it is about 0.5% of GDP in the third quarter. Absolute cost, no question about it. But it is not as large, and the reason the GDP numbers are coming above 7% is because of agriculture, purely because of agriculture. Okay. Now I'll come to your last and the most important point, actually, what should be. What about the attack on black money? You have to understand that when this demonetization happened, some of the leading economists, many leading economists who were against demonetization, and mind you, let me just emphasize, ever since Modi came on the scene, which is 2014, economics is not what it is, politics is not what it is. People are colored. Everybody, maybe I'm colored also, maybe Meghnaz is colored also, maybe Ghatak is colored also, okay? But a large majority of people have blinders on, pre-2014 blinders on. If they thought this way about Modi, therefore everything else, if you're opposed to him, is wrong. Which is why in India, and you know this, everybody knows this, we have revised the GDP numbers several times. And back in 1998, I think, nominal GDP in the 93 base went up by 25%. Nominal GDP this time went up by 0%. In 93, 98, you're economists, all of you guys are economists. How many people wrote editorials on this that we can't trust the GDP data? I mean, this is, you know, political economy, you're a professor of political economy, I think is the most important subject in India today. It's not economics, it's not politics, it's political economy. And people are really operating by their prejudices. And therefore, I have a column called No Proof Required. Now I'll come to your final point about what you do. Look, it's very clear that there are three policies that have to happen. And if you will, for whatever it's worth, I wrote it ex-ante, about a week after the demonetization happened. Three policies have to happen in order for you to attack the creation of black money, which is what your question is, okay? Not this demonetization, if it was all meant to take some black money out, which is quite considerable actually, which I'll come to in a minute, it is the following three for the creation. The sinks. What are the sinks of black money? Real estate, political funding, right? So real estate is where a lot of this money goes. Political funding is where this money goes, and one other, I forget.
Jewelry,
tax evasion, etc. Now, on real estate, policies are already beginning to be in place. On political funding, mind you, all those who've got your colored on glasses over here, on Jaitley's proposal for a bond, was actually proposed by Manmohan Singh in 2003. And Jaitley, to his credit, very openly said, I've taken this idea from him. And that this was an original Manmohan Singh idea in the 2003 report. So therefore, we're beginning to see, if you will, what will likely happen. And the third one was the tax compliance had to go up. And within the tax compliance had to go up, that basically, you know, taliye khatse nahi bache. So if there is a lot of tax evasion in India, and I'll just give you a couple of brief statistics, it had to be fully accompanied by the tax administration of the government of India, which after the BCCI and FIFA is the third most corrupt institution in the world. So therefore, you have to do this business of trying to get your own tax officials as being efficient. Now, last statistic I want to give. In this, and this is how much has been achieved, or will be achieved, and if you will, has been achieved, there's going to be a permanent increase in tax paid by individuals in India. Permanent increase, because they are now in the tax net, and so on and so forth. The government has released the following figures. Of those who deposited a minimum of 80 lakh rupees, 8 million rupees, a minimum, there were 148,000 individuals slash companies slash whatever, 148. The average deposit of cash of these individuals was 3.31 crores, which is 33 million, which is, if you will, 500,000 crispy US dollars. And here we are, you know, the people were saying, oh, you know, smart people, the smart people do not keep cash around. They will put it into real estate. They will put it into foreign exchange. They will buy gold and jewelry. Can you imagine how corrupt we are? And last statement on how corrupt we are. In the US, since 2006, the IRS has been conducting surveys of how much black money, how much tax evasion, sorry, let me call it, the two are synonymous, how much is evaded by tax in personal income tax. They do it for corporate tax, they do it for small businesses tax and personal income tax, and they find out that of every $100 of tax you collect, basically $20 is missed out. It basically means that the compliance rate is about 83%. 83% of all individuals who should pay tax, and the, whether you do it in terms of paying tax, magnitude of tax, or the individuals, it comes to about the same, 83% tax compliance rate. In India, according to the 2013-14 tax data released by the government of India, and this is not much different than the 2002 tax data revealed by the government of India, the tax compliance rate is a grand total of 25%. 25. What does that mean? It means those who should pay taxes, that is above 2.5 lakhs rupees, only 25% of them pay taxes. So the big bonanza, Indian fiscal deficits, you know, you guys are all taught by Meghnad and Ghatak about all the importance of fiscal. Listen, it's going to be a very different picture. This money will come in, has to come in, and is already coming in by these figures, as the tax department is now investigating, and I will give them full credit, they're investigating in a very, very objective data analytic sense. Whereas the political economy is, oh my God, tax terrorism. And that's the last comment I'll make about tax terrorism. Right? You've heard this. Oh, the administration. I already said they're the third most corrupt institution in the world, right? So I'm no fan of the Indian tax administration. But where were all of us for the last 30, 40 years? We didn't think of tax terrorism on the part of the taxpayers who do not pay taxes so that everybody else has to suffer. That's the real tax terrorism that has gone on in India. Forget what the corrupt tax administrators have done. The corrupt is everybody in India. Big time. The culture of corruption is immense in India. You all know it. And that is what demonetization has made a very strong beginning to decrease, not eliminate, but to decrease and significantly decrease the culture of corruption. That is why the rural people, urban people, I was in UP for a week, and really what we asked them, why are you, you know, in favor of Modi, when we asked them who they were going to vote for, etc. It was Modi all the way in UP. This is eastern UP, which, mind you, Gorakhpur has got to be about the dirtiest city in the world. The reason Mayawati and Akhilesh have thrown out is because the people have had enough of them for the last 15 years. Not with Modinomics, if you will, not with demonetization, but basically these corrupt governments have really systematically, if you will, you know, destroyed the society, the system, etc., and really accumulated vast amounts of wealth for themselves. That's the real political story going on. I'm sorry I treaded on your on your toes a little bit, or your discipline, but I really think if I were to study again, I would study political economy.
Sujit, the older you get, you begin to call yourself a political economist. because the younger are getting more technical.
Yeah.
They say, who is this old man talking, you know? Anyway, I think I'll only answer the thing about the corruption. One thing one can do, having demonetized once, it should demonetize again. You know, I've said this in print. I said lightning can strike twice. Everybody is on notice. You put a cash hold, we will take away that currency. And I actually think what they should do Every time they print 2,000 rupee note, whatever it is, they should have a serial number, maybe by the calendar year, whatever. They say, series A is demonetized, series B is demonetized. And it's kind of, you know, spread real terror in the hearts of people that you hold cash, you'll lose money. You know, that you have to do that. But that is my own private plan. I actually also think, and this is not to do just with the Indian economy, I've said this about the British economy, is that there should be no income tax, there should only be consumption taxes. I think, you know, basically... Sorry?
No, go ahead.
You know, what you should do, I mean, for example, in India, when I go out to eat in some fancy restaurant, the tax take of my final bill, it's a very nice, hefty 30-35% of the total bill.
Yeah.
And I'm very happy to pay because I'm enjoying myself. Tax me when I'm enjoying myself. Don't tax me when I'm working. Tax me when I'm enjoying myself. Right? I mean, there's the secret of good taxation is tax people when they're happy. And I think that if they really had stopped this obsession about it, you know, all these people, you know, have economics 101, they think income tax is progressive, consumption taxes are not progressive, therefore it cannot happen. Nobody has even read Kaldor's expenditure tax book, whatever it is. You know, expenditure tax can also be progressive. Consumption tax can be progressive. So have a consumption tax which is self-compliant, auto-compliant. That would be one thing. Second, as I said, you more or less make people sure that all cash holds have temporary lives. And thirdly, I think what has been happening, as Suji said, the number of non-regulation now, that a large cash transaction can no longer be anonymous. That is the case, because what really sustains corruption and black money is anonymity. Cash is anonymous. And you can pass from person to person. But if you say any cash transaction above, say, 2 lakhs has to be with a PAN card and this and that, then you have made these things no longer anonymous, but named. And of course, the larger problem is that corruption happens because there are people in charge of certain access to public resources, and the gatekeepers want to be bribed.
Regulators.
Yeah, I call them gatekeepers. Yeah. Now, you know, obviously what you have to do, you reduce the state's stake in the economy. I mean, I know it's supposed to be a terribly right-wing thing to say, but you know, that is a way to reduce corruption, reduce opportunities for corruption. And it you won't reduce it by increasing the salaries of the civil servant, because salaries will never catch up with how much bribe they can take. I mean, you only have to look at marriage advertisements in India to know how much a dowry a IAS officer rates. And, you know, people are not stupid. So I think one must devise easily compliable rules and arrangements whereby people would pay the tax, and secondly, you have to reduce the opportunities for people to demand corruption, to demand bribes. Having one more very cynical footnote, you know, all of Asia is corrupt, and the East Asia has managed to have miraculous growth rate despite corruption. India somehow has managed not to have miraculous growth rate despite corruption. I don't know what's wrong, but it's not corruption which holds back growth rates. Something else holds back growth rates. Corruption is a matter of morality, of justice, but it's not a matter of economic growth.
So very interesting points by everyone, and it's difficult to find you know, some things to go back on, but the ones that I find most interesting are, you know, what you've just mentioned, that the biggest benefits might have been the, you know, that people who were not paying tax before are now coming into the net, because, you know, otherwise the benefits of demonetization are a bit debatable. So if this was the main benefit that came out, what would you say about some of the reasons we do have cash in developed countries as well, which is, you know, privacy issues or hacking in India, which is a huge problem. I mean, you know, if everything is digitized, there are these other issues of security and so on. And, you know, maybe the politically the state having a lot of information on individuals. So what would all of you have to say about that? I mean, I'll let you...
I mean, information on individuals, Google already has all they need on me. I mean, I can no longer be old-fashioned and object to the government having information on me, because it's okay. All in the cloud. Every transaction I undertake is recorded in the cloud, and so much so that there is no privacy left in the world, thanks to the private sector and the technology. So I think we can no longer have that old-fashioned thing. Well, you know, in this country, actually LSE was responsible for this. There was an idea of having ID cards, which would have considerably simplified life here. But some study group at LSE calculated it would be too expensive to have cards for 60 million people, and India managed to have cards for, you know, the 1,000 million people. And, you know, idiots is like that which hold things back. And of course, we also have people in the UK who have this idea that the government will never find out what I have. You know, the private sector can find out any time. So I think privacy is gone, thanks to the new technology. Yeah. So who cares?
Let me expand. Look, you know, the other important aspect of economics is this is at the LSE of the students here. What I find most useful in economics is to think about the delta, where the delta is the change. We will always have problems. But are the problems, you know, and it's like with technology, et cetera, what about these jobs will be lost, this will happen, et cetera. Always we'll have problems. What we need to look at is how much less problems will there be, or how much greater efficiency in tax collection. And as far as the information ideas go, Meghnad has already answered that. Listen, I mean, if you guys want to live in a utopian world where nobody knows about anybody else, go to the planet Mars. Otherwise, you know, it's just, to me, I find that I'm a libertarian. I believe in privacy. I believe in, you know, bad government needs to be knocked down. But there are other reasons to oppose bad government. Not that they're collecting information on you. I mean,
yeah. Okay, so both Meghnad and Sujit have a lot to agree, so I feel like I have to get a little bit of extra sort of, you know, speak up for the missing whatever somebody who could be sort of have maybe what I jokingly call in one of my columns the all is well corner of the economic commentary on India. So my sort of, there are several things to say, but let me be on point and answer this issue first. So I think that I find it actually very surprising that given that we all agree that political economy is the thing, and if you honestly ask me, if we were not in this forum, what I would be really discussing with the panelists or with any of you is really what was going on in the thinking of the poor. I mean, you know, Meghnad said some interesting things, Sujit said some interesting things. You know, I have some thoughts, but that's really, you know, as to what were the thinking. What, you know, is it more like they don't like the incumbents? Is it more like Modi has emerged as a national figure and there's a brand that they can trust, even though there are temporarily they were inconvenienced by this? We can, you know, discuss all of that. So that's, you know, that's therefore political economy is of course very important. But I think what is surprising though is in a lot of this thinking, I think where I agree with Sujit is that we live in a second best world. Whichever system you have, you can never have zero corruption. Okay. Similarly, you can never have a government that is, you know, fully sensitive to privacy considerations. So, you know, there's no illusion here that if instead of the current government you had a churning and some other outfit comes, suddenly, you know, the problems will go away. But I still think the reason in Germany, for example, you know, the you know, privacy issue concerning cash, that's a very, it's one of the largest cash using among the OECD countries, is I really feel that it's true that private agents like Google and Facebook and so on in the day of WikiLeaks, when right now we might be living out some kind of a Ludlam novel, even Ludlam would have to be high on, you know, cocaine to write a story where it might be that the Russians are working with WikiLeaks and they are informing the White House and fighting FBI and CIA are on the other side. So this is
what might be.
Yeah, exactly. They are. Yeah. So there's a very kind of, you know, it's like Ludlam on high on coke or something. So, but the point is though, In the end, there's no central planner. Modi maybe, you know, clearly has proved himself to be a very high-profile political leader, which really, after Indira Gandhi, it's hard to think of somebody who has, you know, carried the national mandate. So whatever is one's political view, we cannot, as much one cannot question that Virendra Sehwag is a sort of unique, you know, opening batsman who started, scoring, you know, triple centuries. So Modi clearly has that. But this whole benign central planner, benign leader who is all good, the problem is with the implementation. Everybody else is corrupt, but there's a great leader who is somehow above it and who can step, and it's nothing with this context, with any context. I call this the central planner fallacy. That basically there's a great leader who could be in any country that somehow is above the system. It's a bit like Superman or Batman, right? And somebody who could then fly into the system and fix all the corrupt guys, you know, you bang their heads and so on. The problem, I think, is true. Google has information, Facebook has information, but you also have courts. It's the US courts that overturned Trump's, you know, immigration ban, right, the first round. So it is really the sanctity and the effectiveness of our judicial and enforcement institution that should be. Otherwise, with technology, sure, I might be having lots of information about you, but if I try to use it, if I try to sort of abuse it, there should be a legal enforcement system. So my question to that is, again, we are all academics or sort of, you know, thinkers, writers, so we don't have to be partisan here. I cannot think of any political administration in India where the courts were reasonably independent, where information was sort of, you know, so therefore to have this much faith in the court system, so that with Aadhaar, recently we had to get midday meals, the kids will have to have an Aadhaar card, which then the government quickly, you know, backed off and so on. This to me seems to be, as much as I'm not a privacy fundamentalist in the same way as these guys were discussing, you know, we have to, it's reality, every time you use your credit card, somebody somewhere is, you know, compiling all these things, you know, so that's fair enough. But with our judicial systems, I would take, it's the classic thing of democracy. Democracy is so inefficient. If we had China, it's the classic thing. If we were China, we could just bulldoze over, build the roads, do everything, right? But there's a reason why democracy is also a good thing. And as Meghnad, you know, in the few things I actually agree with him, you know, corruption is a symptom to a systemic failure. But like all pollution or garbage dumps, it can never be zero. I mean, even in the US, I mean, you know, it's unrealistic thing place can be zero. So the question is the delta, what will reduce it? And that's where I think the privacy considerations in the Indian context, where known criminals get acquitted when political parties sort of, you know, there's turnover in political parties. I don't have to give, you know, you can create equal opportunity examples across, you know, whether it's state governments, whether it's, you know, federal government, that once a new regime comes to power, certain guys gets acquitted and so on. So given this, do I want to give this highly powerful machinery in the hands of a central federal government with lots of powers, right, who could overturn state governments and so on? I would actually be, is the classic that even though Surjit sort of gave me a perhaps well-deserved dig as a Bengali leftist economist, but I'm also a Chicago libertarian economist. I'm both at the same time. You know, that's where I taught, and that's where, so I'm both a leftist and a libertarian, and I can answer. Exactly. And therefore, my point is, therefore, this is where the libertarian, the Ronald Coase or the Hayek follower in me is disturbed, that one of the reasons I think private enterprise is good is because it's dispersed, it's decentralized. I don't want big monopolies, whether it's in the private sector or in the government sector having too much power. So that's my concern. Having said that, you know, on this, I think we have some common ground. I'm not taking an extreme position.
Let me, can I just, look, you know, if any of you have not seen Snowden, you should go see it. What you're describing.
The movie. Yeah.
Well, Snowden himself and the movie is about is already happening.
I'll get you the number from you.
Is already happening. So in other words, and this is happening in the most free, most democratic country in the world. Forget India. This is happening in the US. They are spying on everybody. So you see the movie, you've heard what Snowden. But what I want to point out, and this applies, and the Snowden example is a perfect manifestation of why I think all is well, you know, relatively speaking, is that, you know, look, there's no place to hide anymore, especially for the government. Because of this information, the checks and balances, whether you're democratic or whether you're Chinese,
right? There are immensely more checks and balances on the system than there were ever before, regardless of its political orientation. That's the great savings. That is, the checks and balances, information. Everybody has information, yeah. Not just the government. So therefore, and you saw the great fight with Apple on the WhatsApp, where they wouldn't disclose it, etc. So I think, you know, it's a brave new world with lots of checks and balances, not perfect by definition. If it was perfect, the world won't be there, or we won't call it a world. And, you know, that's the hope, and I think information is going to be helpful, and the government misuses it. And you just gave an example. I'm not so sure where I fall on the Aadhaar thing, but that's checks and balances working in the system. And you know, do not think that India, illiterate country, this, that, etc. There are lots of checks and balances in the system, and we just saw in the election process a manifestation. But I didn't complete the story on the 1 week as to what the poor really think about this. So they all admitted they had been hurt. They said, well, we lost a job, this, that, or had less income, etc. And the range was about 25 to 50% decline in November. Then they said things are now coming back to normal. If it was the youth who were very much for, the youth poor, the youth, you know, lower middle class, was much more for Modi than the elderly. And they thought things were coming back to normal. And they also had, and Meghnad mentioned this a little bit of pleasure. In that the rich were getting hurt more.
Sure.
They admitted, you know, usko to pakda gaya na, uska jaan gaya loss. But they also think and believe, and this is where my hypothesis of checks and balances would come in, that he means well, he will, and this goes back to your original question, if he does not, he meaning the Indian government and Modi, I guess it's more Modi than anybody else, does not implement changes, he will be thrown out. And I think, I can't speak for him, but I think he realizes that. And we'll soon find out as to whether economic reforms accelerate or decelerate, whether political reforms accelerate, decelerate, what happens on political funding, you know, so on and so forth. We might even see a decline, at least here's my hope coming in, that the tax rates, which are also by the state governments and all, are very, very high on the GST. They might have alcohol and petroleum back. You know, I just think that the checks and balances, the knowledge, and the belief that he has to do something on the economy and reforms is paramount, and let's hope he realizes that.
Thank you. That's reassuring from you. But one last question.
I'll stop now.
Because then you have to
No more. Not at all.
One last question, and Lord Desai can start off before we have the audience. This is, you know, because I've heard this from Kuljeet a lot and from you as well, that, you know, the poor, either they were not affected that badly, or that by their, you know, their support for Modi are showing that basically they kind of preferred to have to give up, you know, or to sacrifice themselves because the rich would suffer more. So it's a kind of a suicide bomber mentality, according to me, but... In any case, do you think, so my question is, do you think the, you know, today's results is kind of a referendum on demonetization, or is it other things going on? Because there's so many different things about the opposition being weak, the huge, you know, mobilization that the BJP does. So what are your opinions on this issue? Would you think of the UP result as a referendum result, as a sort of on demonetization or not?
Let him speak. Then I'll forget that I've spoken. So let them speak.
Okay, so I'll be very happy, you know, if Meghnad comes in. Sort of going back to your question, look, it's clearly a referendum on Modi and his policies, of which demonetization is one big band one. So it'll be, you know, sort of churlish to deny the fact that he campaigned intensively, as he did in Bihar, and there it didn't work out, but this time in UK it did work out. So, you know, it's like cricket, like, you know, this match he won big, there's no doubt about it. And if he lost it, we would have all said that this is the failure of demonetization. Since he won big, we have to admit that whether that was good or bad, or as I think, you know, I can now quote Surjit on this, which will be in a way more credible, that there was a shock to the informal sector. Some of the numbers reported was 30% or so, which is within his experience. And also one of the things that I wanted to add, but I think now on this we have enough agreement, so I'll just briefly mention it. NREGA sort of, you know, utilization went up fairly significantly right after this policy, and that's why in the current budgetary numbers, you know, NREGA allocation, you know, actually shows a greater increase than it did earlier. And again, if you did not have informal sector folks coming back to their villages and looking for jobs, this would not happen. But that's a, you know, that's a different issue. So yes, I think it's sort of at least partly a referendum on demonetization, and at least by, even though since we talked about being Bengali and Mamata Banerjee and the cash, you also have Punjab and the drug problem, Urta Punjab, and the fact that the BJP SAD was, you know, convincingly defeated there. So the point is, look, I think that I am less optimistic than Surjit as to the fact that in Kerala, given the anti-incumbency cycles that you have, I would be more optimistic if all of India was like that. But I'm from a state where the left-front government was in power for 34 years. And again, in Uttar Pradesh, you know, you have had really one awful government, you know, followed by another awful government and so on. Similarly, Indira Gandhi was in power for, you know, stretches, although, you know, that was clearly not as continuous and so on. So I'm overall less sanguine about somehow democracy is, you know, good at sort of economic performance. You can, in an ideal world, then, you know, good economic performance should be rewarded and so on, but often it doesn't happen. Okay, so in this case, where I do at least have some common ground with Surjit is, look, this is the classic midpoint. You know, the next elections are 2019. And I think, as I said, that if the trend continues, Modi can expect to be power until 2024. That's 10 years. So if then we can't be debating third quarter and kharif cropping estimates being good or which economy said that or so. You know, as much as Manmohan Singh, when all the dust settles, whatever you say about, you know, how what he says right now, but he was the architect of the 91 reforms, and of course Rao facilitated him, and history books will, you know, have to judge that. What, you know, I was just looking at a paper that looks at the growth peaks. It started actually in the 80s, interestingly, as people have followed it. So I think in 2024, so maybe I'm thinking way too forward, we would need to see the bar charts which have gone up above what Mr. Jaitley at LSE called the new normal, which is the 6-7%. So we would need a period at least in which the growth rate is, you know, above that and employment is generated. If that happens, then whatever is the political fortunes of the BJP and Modi, we will have to acknowledge he delivered on some of the promises. Otherwise, we'll have to say it's like Indira Gandhi's Garibi Hatao. Garibi didn't go away. I mean, you know, that was a big thing. She won elections. All that happened. But Garibi did not go away. It took, you know, reforms and subsequent work to had bite on that.
Inga, do you go? I'll go last.
No, there's nothing.
Yeah, come on.
You know, I mean, no election, the world is not univariate. No election is a test of a single hypothesis. So this election cannot be a test of demonetization.
But I want to speak a little bit. This keeps coming up, and as it happens, is something I've worked on quite a bit. You know, about the great period of economic growth in India, by any definition, was between 2004-05 to about 2007-08, and then things went all right. But let's look at the period, this employment issue. I think you raised it, etc. That between 2004-05 and 2011-12, including NREGA, SHREGA, and all the rest of it, job growth in India was 0.8% per annum. This is in the great, what I'm trying to say there, something, and this is a researchable topic for people like you and me and Meghnath and the rest of you in a couple of years from now, and maybe a fantastic PhD thesis for those who are working. What the hell is going on with India's employment numbers? Between 2004-05 and 2011-12, real wages went up 5% or so. So what is this? And if you will,
Another thing to look at, you must have seen this FD had a big splurge on it and everything else. It made news all over the world, even in, you know, CNN, etc. That there were 8 peon jobs in UP that were advertised. And there were 4 lakh applicants. So what did the uninformed, which is the CNN and all the rest of them, quickly jump to? Oh my God, massive unemployment problem in India. There are these 2 lakh people applying for 8 peon jobs, and several of them are PhDs and this and that and whatever. Well, you know, we know all from basic economics, Econ 101, actually should be called Econ 01, comes long before 101, that the wage in the public sector has, you know, this is the socialist policies, and actually, I just want to take, you know, in West Bengal, you guys didn't see any difference between CPA and people. But that's my view. So you guys are suffering from the same thing. But you know, the whole problem is the public sector, wage setting, this Fabian socialism in the name of the poor Indira Gandhi economics has destroyed the Indian economy to a very large extent. The wage in the public sector is about class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4 is about 3 times higher than what you would get in the private sector. I would apply for a job if I was had the privilege and the good fortune of going abroad for studies or whatever you might call it. So the point is that let's examine why is I don't think the real wage data, which is the only thing I can trust, is conforms with employment growth being massively low or unemployment growth being massively high. To the extent we want to trust, CMIE has an unemployment data, which they started collecting 1.5 years, that shows 3 or 4%. To the extent the you want to trust the NSS data, has never shown unemployment more than 4%, 4.5%. So please do not use, and everybody uses it, okay? Whether it's the government, whether it's the critics of the government, everybody says we got these 12 million jobs, you know, people coming to the labor force, and I'm not taking an agnostic position. I'm taking an agnostic position because I really haven't completed my study on this data. But I guarantee you the likelihood that this is a lot of mismeasurement problem, like a problem of measurement of poverty in India. It's a lot of mismeasurement. That doesn't mean we shouldn't provide better jobs. That doesn't mean we shouldn't skill development, all the rest of it. But don't think there are masses of Indians all lying around for FT to come and discover that they suddenly don't have a job.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to have to close the discussion here, but let's open the panel to questions from the audience. There's a mic here, so come here first.
Hi, my name is Kripa Shah. I'm loud enough, but thank you. Thank you for your talk. A few minutes back, we had some great businessmen with a lot of optimism on India and, you know, youth, social entrepreneurship and all of that. And economists tend to be a little more realistic, dare I say cynical, right? With tax corruption, with terrorism, with the unemployment figures as we just spoke. I want you to answer the question that, you know, the India Forum is on. Do you really see India politically and economically strong enough to be the next superpower in the making? Thank you.
Next to do what?
Next superpower.
Who's the question?
Yes.
Can you? But you just spoke about it.
My numbers would start in 2000. From 2000 onwards, the growth trajectory of the Indian economy, even including the bad couple of bad years under UPA 2, are way above what they were through the first 53 years of the since independence, since 47 to 2000. And, you know, as Maitra said, you know, the new normal is 7%. 7%, yeah, 7% is sort of, 7 or above 7, the new normal. And I think with a little bit of reform I was actually blaming the PMO because I want civil service reform as well. the Prime Minister relies on the civil service, the civil service is lousy, you can't have good reform if it's a lousy civil service. But, you know, with proper reform, structural reform in the Indian economy, there is no reason why India should not grow at 9 to 9.5%. I mean, other East Asian economies have grown. It's not rocket science. So, yeah, I've no doubt that India can be a superpower. I mean, in my view, superpower requires not high income but other things, but we won't go into that. You know, like no untouchability, no gender discrimination, etc. But we won't go into that. That is another seminar.
I think we'll take a couple of, maybe two or three questions and then ask the panelists to respond. So first, I think it was this person.
Thank you. Mahendra Jadeja, representing UK India Consultancy and many communities. We all talk about it last 4 months and 3 days today, about the demonetization and implementation. Gentleman, Professor, he just mentioned about it, implementation. I was the first Indian in the retail sector to apply for the EPOS system before even the W.S. Smiths applied in this country. I was the first Asian to put the ATM machine in this country. Now, I have got the good respect with the Lord Desai, and they say, look, we have to put the creative of the fairness within the industry to, find that there is a bomb there or something like that, and military going around there. But looking at the implementation in this country, we talk about what's happening in India, but the learned people living in here, they are not easy about it. The NRI should have the problem, and they're going backward and forward to put their legitimate money back into the country. Then when they go back into the India, we thought we British Indian are NRI. Unfortunately, according to the government, we are not NRI. NRI means Indian living abroad more than 6 months. They're NRI.
We have to keep it short, please.
Yeah, but you talk about it. What is your thing about the? Did they do the right thing for the implementation to this country where people are living there? Because I wanted to have your thoughts. How can they improve it?
Thank you.
Sure.
The next person.
Why should I be concerned?
I think the next question.
Why should I be concerned with that problem?
Because you're not thinking that this country is better back to India. You're just looking after yourself and go on the TV and talk about the big things there. But you have to talk about the communities and people who actually spend a lot of time when the Indian government wanted to have a home there and mother wanted money there. NRI helped them. Now NRI, when they go back into the country to put their money there, you don't have them.
Why should anybody help?
Why not?
You take your risk. You got the money. Don't go then. Don't put the money there. Don't put the money there. Don't put the money there. Why always have infant protection?
I think you have your own agenda. You go on the TV.
Sir, this is a Q&A session. Please let's stick to questions here. Short questions.
We'll just take a few more questions because we are running short of time. So I think there was a gentleman here. Yeah.
My name is George. I study public policy at UCL. Dr. Desai, it is very easy for us to sit in an air-conditioned room and say demonetization could should be implemented again. Why not? Lightning strike twice. Just imagine the condition in India where 86% of the currency is taken out and 80% of the population is standing for weeks and weeks on snake lines, many people dying on the streets, and we have made a lot of cost benefit analysis today. One simple question: do you really think that given the large amount of the majority of elitist and the rich people walking really free today, not quite affected by the demonetization, and the majority of the population being completely affected by demonetization, do you really think you want to do it again?
OK, Okay, see, next.
I'll answer that.
Let's keep a few questions before we answer. So I want to finish off the question.
Hi, I'm Shankar MB from Exchanger. Just want to understand, so if not demonetization, what else can be there to cure corruption? And secondly, if it happens in the future, what's the ideal implementation plan according to you guys?
Okay, then last, one more question.
What's the question?
The question was about other possible policies for corruption.
Yeah, other possible policies instead of demonetization.
And how to improve
them? What to encourage corruption or to reduce?
Maybe one last question and then
go either way. Wrap up. I'm an economist. I can advise either way.
This is the last question.
I'd like to ask, beyond the economic question, what about the legal question, using an ordinance to pass the demonetization policy without having it as law first? Does that concern the panel? Thank you.
What's the question?
The legal basis for doing it as an ordinance.
I know, poor Amante Singh got it all wrong.
Yeah, I think we can. Not addressed to anybody specifically.
Yeah, you start with another.
Sir, okay. The first question, yeah. You know, if you had listened to me carefully, what I was saying was that the problem was not getting the new currency on the spot early enough. If the new currency had been there available, a lot of this hardship would have been avoided. And, you know, so in a sense, yes, the hardship was there, is very regrettable, but that hardship was entirely avoidable. It had nothing to do with the elimination of old money. It had to do with the availability of new money. Okay, so that is my answer. I think air-conditioned rooms have nothing to do with this. I can think in a hot room as well as an air-conditioned room. My thoughts don't change because of the temperature of the thing. About corruption, you know, I think in a sense what it is, that we already talked about it, that you basically remove the anonymity of large cash transactions. If you can effectively do that, and as Surjit pointed out, if there are bank deposits done by people which are large, and if you can chase them through, then you'd be able to reduce the possibility of people doing this again. You know, but ultimately you can only eliminate corruption either by eliminating scarcity, which you can't, or eliminating the power of gatekeepers to delay or postpone or make you jump the queue or stop you from doing something, and that kind of. It's very difficult to stop that sort of arbitrary power because ultimately you can't let state resources go away unchecked. And the people who are the check, it's a kind of human folly. Let's minimize it if possible, and let us reduce the incidence on the poor people of corruption. If the rich act, I don't mind about high corruption. High corruption is high corruption. I mind really about petty corruption. Let's eliminate petty corruption.
Okay, so I'll just collecting some of the comments. I think that going back to one of the earlier questions about India being a superpower, so of course I think India, by its sort of, you know, the glorious civilization that it represents, and the fact that we really are a very diverse country, a large country which has sort of continued democratically for a long time. I think we need to economically grow fast, and the main argument would be to lift the poor. I mean, for me, that's really the main consideration, as opposed to getting more people in the top 10 richest people list in the world, which is fine. I have no problems with that. But for me, that's a moral purpose here. And I actually have shared ground with Meghnad when he said that, look, to be a superpower, it's not like having bigger missiles or having sort of, you know, if we kind of go back to the original notion of superpowers, if the U.S. was a superpower, maybe it still is, I don't know, Russia and so on, that it's really about, getting a sort of, you know, a sort of cleaner environment, protecting tribals' rights, protecting, you know, lower caste from discrimination, protecting religious minority freedoms, and gender discrimination. You know, these are things that I think as Indians, it doesn't matter what your particular, you know, whether I'm a Bengali leftist or a Punjabi libertarian, we should all agree on this. So therefore, I really want to say this in an inclusive spirit, that whatever we do, we really should not confuse patriotism and the desire to be a superpower with any particular political party or thing. We really, I mean, in the end, us and our children and grandchildren, I mean, they will be known as Indians, and therefore we want sort of what's good for that. So being superpower, I would worry about just an exclusive focus on the military might and all of that, but of course we need that. But coming back to, I really think that where the challenge is, and I honestly, so the legal question about the currency, I have read some accounts of it, but I'm not enough of a legal expert. But if you ask me, as a non-legal expert, but as an argumentative Indian who has an opinion on everything, I would worry about it, because in some ways a legal tender is a legal tender. But having said that, I can also see what Meghnad would say, that look, you're exchanging it. So at some level, therefore, you know, there has to be some leeway in these processes. So even though I'm critical of this policy, I cannot be an absolutist in you know, for example, something is discovered in some paper that's problematic, say, for, you know, people to, you know, some safety issue, right? Then the fact that you could recall things, I think that should be allowed for that, right? And the only final remark I'll make before I, you know, let Sujit answer to some of these questions is, look, I think corruption is a big problem, but we also get a bit obsessed with corruption. You know, I mean, it's a bit like it's the classic blind man and the elephant. You know, environmentalists are just concerned. They're not concerned with GDP. They're not concerned that much with it. It's all about pollution. Similarly, those who are kind of really concerned about, you know, growth rate and opportunity, then you're just thinking about that, not thinking of other things. So we really, I think we should be clear in terms of what's the final outcome that we are concerned with, and that's the quality of life of ordinary Indians, of, you know, any economic and social profile. That's really should be our main objective. But this is where I continue to worry about the government being too powerful in dimensions, where I worry about the government having such, you know, sharp instruments or weapons in its arsenal without adequate legal safeguards for the ordinary citizens. Okay, so this is something that I would really worry about. But on the other hand, I'm also equally supportive of what Meghnad said, that in the end, we have to unleash the private sort of, you know, initiative of individuals. So all the, you know, gatekeeping and the multiple windows and so on, the entry barriers, they should also be lowered. So all this is a way of actually reducing the power of the government. And yet what I worry about is that in the tone of what we discuss is we are reposing a lot of faith in sort of the government having, you know, lots of information, passing arbitrary laws to do changes and so on. So this is a paradox we have to grapple with. Do we want the government to become stronger and stronger? Or do we actually want to government sort of, you know, empower institutions so that the citizens are more empowered?
Okay, so before Surjit takes over, we have just 1 minute because I'm getting urgent looks from the organizers. So I give you a minute to just wrap up your thoughts. And
very quickly, I have a minute.
You can have 5 minutes.
A minute.
So there, and I'm going to take a really, that's why I asked whether I have a minute at least. I'm going to say two long run things. Okay. One, I won't worry at all, and this is not long run, this is just an aside, about the legal things been done in several countries, including India, in 1978 and in 1946. And funny thing, nobody raised the legal issue then, and they're raising it now. But really, let me emphasize two long run things, which goes back to the first question about, is India a superpower in the making? And the answer is very unequivocally yes. But here's the long run thing. Between 1500 and 1980, India and China had the same per capita income, give or take, plus minus 15%. China is now three and a half times our per capita income. This is, you know, if you will, we are in disequilibrium. And if, you know, we want to take a long run view, we are in extreme disequilibrium, and therefore what the next 20, 30 years suggest, that India will grow much faster than China. So that's the first part about how we might. The second part, and we are Johnny come lately, India is, etc., and we're not given enough credit for the things we have done right. And this is prior to Modi, so if you will, prior to 2014, we've done a lot of things right. And God only knows, and we all know, we've done many things wrong. there is a revolution going on in India. And that revolution, all you guys, especially you gals, are part of. Create gender inequality. In 1983, young women, ages 15 to 24 in urban areas, had two-thirds the wages of young men. All NSS data. And we had my favorite leftist economists all coming out and saying the market is discriminating, this, that, whatever. It turned out they had two-thirds the education of young men. So the discrimination was not in the market, was in the home, where the girl child was treated on a very, very, on a very unequal basis. In 2011-12, long before, thankfully, Modi made it a national thing, Beti Padao, Beti Bachao, etc. In 2011-12, young women, ages 15 to 24 in urban areas, had 1% more wages, and if you will, had slightly more education than young men. Now, we all know that they, if you will, this doesn't take into account the quality of education or their ability. Every survey, everywhere in India, everywhere in the world, shows that young women or girls are performing better than boys. Okay? So we have come at a very late stage. So I think this is going to be, this productivity unleashing, if the women will also now at a higher level, or the Indians are now at a higher level, they're not going to stay at home, they're going to work. This is a productivity unleash that is emerging in India, which will not only sustain the 7% growth rate, but it will, if you will, enhance it to 8, 8.5. In the long run, which is the next 20 years, you guys will be there to enjoy it. This is India's decade, India's 20 years. Last caveat. In 1991, I wrote a piece called This is India's Decade. In 2001, I wrote a piece called This is India's Decade. And most recently, in 2011, I wrote a piece called This is India's Decade. Third time, I'm right. Thank you.